It gives me great pleasure to introduce Suzanne Gordon, who's an award-winning journalist and author. She's written for the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times, the Washington Post, and a number of other publications. And she's the co-editor of the Culture and Politics of Healthcare Work series at Cornell University Press. I first heard Suzanne when she spoke at UCSF a number of years ago, but I really became a fan when I read the book on advocacy for nurses that she co-authored, From Silence to Voice, What Nurses Know and Must Communicate to the Public. And that book has been the basis for several workshops on advocacy that I've been involved in at APNA conferences. Suzanne is the author of seven books, including Life Support, Three Nurses on the Front Lines, published by Little Brown and Company. She also edited When Chicken Soup Isn't Enough, Stories of Nurses Standing Up for Themselves, Their Patients, and Their Profession. And her book, Beyond the Checklist, What Else the Healthcare Industry Can Learn from Aviation Safety and Teamwork, was recently published by Cornell University Press. The book was co-written with pilot Patrick Mendenhall and medical educator Bonnie Blair O'Connor. So please join me in welcoming Suzanne Gordon.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me here with you today. I'm delighted to be here. As many of you know, I'm a journalist and an editor, not a nurse. I've been writing about nursing for about 28 years. So of my 43-year career as a journalist, it's scary to think that you've been doing something that long. How many of you have been nurses for 40 years? Okay, right? Is it time for us to quit or what, you know? Maybe we can all get together after and talk about, like, switching careers or retiring. How many of you have been a nurse for just a couple of years? I can barely see you, but do we have any? So, we need a big hand. The new nurses in the group, the 1-2 year nurses, come up here. I have a little present for you after the presentation, really, seriously, because we need to really celebrate. Because those of us who've been doing what we've been doing for, you know, 40 odd years or more, we're sort of on the way out and into the bed, right? And we need you to be at our side. So we need more people in this room to be nurses of all sorts. And after 40 years of something, we probably all need psych nurses, like, a lot, right? But at any rate, I'm not a nurse. I'm a doctor or any health professional of any sort. I'm a journalist. And I've been observing nurses for about 28 years of my 43-year career. And nurses really have taught me everything that I know about healthcare. I edited a series of books on healthcare called The Culture and Politics of Healthcare Work for Cornell University Press. And I've written about 16 or 17 books. It's hard to keep track. It's like you with your patients. How many patients have you taken care of, right? It's sort of you. It all becomes a blur. I've written a lot of books about healthcare, including the one that Nick kindly mentioned called Beyond the Checklist, What Else Healthcare Can Learn from Aviation Teamwork and Safety. And a lot of what I'm going to talk to you about today comes from that. But it also comes from my having worked with nurses about this problem of silence to voice that Beth mentioned. I did a book with another journalist called Bernice Baresh, From Silence to Voice, What Nurses Know and Must Communicate to the Public. And we just came out with our third edition of that book, which, if any of you have read the first and second, we think is even better and is quite different. And I've been really preoccupied with this issue of nurses' voice. And I know that Tom Rath spoke about this issue yesterday, about your undercapitalization. Is that correct? I wish I'd been here to listen to that, because I've been shocked from the minute I walked into hospitals and other healthcare institutions to watch nurses work. I've been shocked at how extraordinary their work is and how little they talk about it, how little they make of it. I'm going to ask you a question, and I'd appreciate it if you'd all raise your hands if you agree. Do you agree that the public trusts nurses? Raise your hands. Okay, now take those in the front. Keep your hands up. Those in the front, look in the back and just get a sense of, like, what kind of hand action we have here. Okay, now I'm going to ask you another question. Raise your hands if you think it's true. Do you think the public understands what nurses do? Okay, guys, look around. Look around at the hands. Okay, so here we have this, what I call the trust trap. Everybody believes, and this is the same every country I go to, every group I go to. I ask this question, and we have the same thing. We have the same phenomenon. Everybody raises their hands when I ask if the public trusts nurses. Nobody, except maybe a smattering, raises their hand when I ask if people understand what nurses do. I've been asking this question now for about 20 years because, you know, there's all these surveys about, oh, the public trusts nurses, and then nurses are, like, so happy because the public trusts us. And then I think it becomes like a placebo effect, medication. No, actually, let's not placebos. Placebos are great. It's almost a nocebo effect. It has a negative effect because it lulls nurses into a sense of complacency. Well, why do we need to talk about our work? They trust us. Well, Winston Churchill trusted his nanny, but it was real clear in the pecking order where his nanny was, right? So trust is a great foundation upon which to build an edifice of understanding. I don't want to knock trust. Think of trust as a foundation, right? It's a great foundation upon which to build an edifice of understanding. But if you don't understand what people do, really, if you don't know why they're there, if you don't have the intelligence cultivated by that group to tell you what they're doing and why they're there, then trust is a foundation that has no building on it, right? And think of a big foundation, and, you know, we've all passed them on the in large cities where they're building a, you know, a huge skyscraper, and there's the foundation, and, you know, rain's gotten in it, and cigarette butts and tin cans, and, you know, it's a great foundation. It's really sturdy, but right now it's got a lot of junk in it. And I would argue that with nursing, we have an amazing foundation that people are not building on, right? To this day, people are not building on. And I would argue that this is a danger to patient safety, because if nurses are the keystone, wherever you are, nurses are the keystone. They're the safety net. You always say that, right? The patient advocate, et cetera, et cetera. But if people don't know what they do, they won't pay for you to do it, right? If they think you're nice and kind and sweet, which countless nursing organizations promote, these images of hearts and flowers, I can do a whole presentation on that if you don't believe me. But, and we have a detailed analysis of that in From Silence to Voice. We now have the DAISY Awards, right? In which nurses are given Cinnabons and a box of Kleenex and a statue of a little tiny statue of a mother and baby, as if nurses were nursing in, you know, that sense of the word. This is a big problem, right? Because if we think that it's just intuitive, it's just female intuition, and then a couple of weird guys who, you know, are snags, sensitive new age guys, right? We're not going to give you the resources that you need, the education you need, the money you need, the time you need to do your work. And I have believed from the beginning of my real perplexity with this dilemma of having 2.7, it bounces around 2.6, 2.7 million men and women doing nursing and people still not understanding what they do. And I agree with you. Nobody does understand. Very few people understand what you do. Why is that, ladies and gentlemen? Why is it that they don't understand what you do? Because you don't tell them, right? Because you don't tell them. I once was at a nursing conference where a young woman said, well, but it's not for me as an individual nurse to tell people what I do. It's my organization, my union, my professional group, my, you know, state nurses group. And I said, you know, obviously your union, your professional organization, your group, your whatever, should, your hospital, your healthcare institution should be telling people what nurses do. But you see, as a nurse, how many of you work in direct care in a hospital? Okay, how many of you are clin specs or psych NPs, or how many of you are professors? All right, whatever you are, you see X amount of students a day, X amount of patients a day, X amount of clients a day, right? 10, 20, 30, over the course of a year, do the math. How many people do you come in contact with? Hundreds of people over a career, these 40-year lifers like me, come in contact with thousands of people. All of you put together, I mean, you know, 2.7 million nurses, do the math. You got the country covered. Right? People should understand what you do. And as psych nurses, maybe somebody should do a psych study about the pathology of silence in nursing. Right? Because I think it is a pathology. Right? Why people don't want to talk about the good things that they do is a mystery to me. I mean, I think I may have cracked the mystery because of the history of nursing's origins in religious institutions and the sort of, if you say good things about yourself or your work or your, you know, profession, that's somehow the sin of pride. I mean, but I think that has a lot to do with it. But also, people are not supporting each other in ending the silence. They're not complimenting each other when they speak up. They're not providing psychological safety for each other. I can't tell you the times I've heard nurses say, oh, we've heard enough from her, right? We've heard enough from her. Or I was once, I asked to speak at Walter Reed right after the Iraq war was declared, and they were bringing soldiers back from Iraq who were wounded, and they had a journalist, an embedded journalist, who was, with permission from the president and the Pentagon, with these soldiers in Iraq. And the journalist was in Walter Reed, and a bunch of nurse managers were talking about how this journalist were there. And I'm about to say, oh, God, that's great. You guys can get to know the journalist and talk about nursing. And this manager says, so I told my nurses not to talk to them, to stay away from them, to protect the patient, you know. And I said, wait a minute, guys. The President of the United States, who I wasn't very fond of, but that's okay, and the Secretary of Defense, et cetera, have said that this guy from the Washington Post or wherever he was should be at Walter Reed. I mean, it's not just that the soldier said it and how much higher can you get? And you're telling nurses to stay away from the journalist? So that they will once again believe the doctor did it all? I mean, this is, you know, Einstein's definition of insanity, right? Doing the same thing over and over again. I mean, it's really interesting. So as psych nurses, one of the things I've been impressed throughout my career writing about nurses is the leadership. And I'm not just saying this because, you know, I'm here and want to make nice to you, but it's true. Psych nurses have a lot of very big leadership positions in nursing, right? They're very astute. You guys understand not just the physical, but the emotional. You understand the connection between the two, which is a lot, you know, which is an enormous advantage. You have a lot of psychological understanding. We need you to help your colleagues to overcome this problem of self-silencing. And if you don't overcome it, we as patients will suffer. This is not about you, really. It's about us. I'm not a nurse. I when I'm in a group like this, I'm always, you know, I'm a graduate school dropout, actually. I'm a proud graduate school dropout, but I'm a graduate school dropout. I was getting a PhD in French literature, and I dropped into journalism. And so I just have this lonely BA after my name, and, you know, I'm always with people who are BSN and MSN and MPH and PPH and blah, blah, blah. And you know, I've got just two little ones, two cute little, at the very beginning of the alphabet ones, not in that order, right? And sometimes I want to put down SP or PP, BASP or PP, which is sometime patient or potential patient. And actually, everyone in this room is an SP or PP, right? Because we'll all need some kind of nursing care, either mental health care or physical health care. And if the government doesn't get it together, we'll really need it because, you know. In fact, I woke up this morning thinking, you know what you guys all should do? You should leave this meeting, all get on a plane and go to Washington, and then Congress would have a 2-to-1 ratio, right? And maybe with your help, they could work it out. Because they don't seem to be able to do it for themselves, and that would be a great way to show what you do, right? Psych nurses march on Washington to get government going again, right? I can see the headline. So, but seriously, your leadership in this issue of speech, of speaking up, of helping nurses find their voice is critical. You know, nurses talk all the time to me about patient advocacy. But then I can't get them to tell their stories, and you can't help but think, well, wait a minute. If you can't stand up in a room of your colleagues and say what you do, how can I believe that you're going to tell that doctor that he's about to cut off, you know, the wrong leg? Or, you know, or wait, no, the patient may not be delusional or whatever, you know, whatever it is. So, and I think we have a big problem in speaking up. I just got a very sad email from a young man who was an adventure guide, I mean a wilderness guide, before going to a master's program, a very prominent master's program in nursing, and to become an NP. And he said, in the wilderness, we have to work as teams, because if we don't, people die. And we have to speak up if we see danger or if somebody's doing something that could endanger somebody, no matter what their rank is or whatever. And he said, and I quote, going to nursing school has been, and this is a master's entry program in NP, has been a crippling experience because I watch physicians not wash their hands over and over again. And nobody says anything. And I go to my nurse manager and she says, you don't want to be one of those guys that's telling everybody what to do. And he said, and I quote, I'm crippled by shame. There is a reason that we are killing not 98,000. Everybody here knows the IOM study that came out in 1999. 98,000 people die from preventable medical errors and injuries. No, it's not 98,000. That came out in 1999. There was just a study, 2010, by Medicare, 180,000 Medicare recipients die from medical errors and injuries. And now another journal published another study, and I believe it, and so does Lucian Leap and every other person in patient safety, that it's not 98,000. It's between 220 and 440,000 people die every year. Some of them your patients, from preventable medical errors and injuries. Some from mismanagemental illness. Some from, you know, everything. And we injure 1.5 million people a year preventably. So there is a big problem. And speaking up is part of that problem. And I want to build on what the speaker spoke about yesterday and talk about what do people need to speak up? What do people need? And how can psych nurses help them speak up? And what do they need to speak up about, right? Because there's lots of issues that we need to address. Now, you know all about emotional intelligence, I'm sure. And people in healthcare are talking a lot about emotional intelligence. And emotional intelligence is very important in helping people relate to one another. But I think from the point of view of patient safety, from the point of view of patient care and quality, wherever it's delivered, the really critical issue is to build on emotional intelligence to achieve what I call team intelligence. Because team intelligence is what we need to get a job done. And team intelligence is dependent on this issue of psychological safety and people understanding what each other do. This issue of the public not understanding what you do is a problem, a failure of team intelligence throughout the healthcare system, right? We have to understand what each other does, what the roles that people play on a team, or you don't have a team. Now, I've studied aviation for about 8 years because I got really interested in this concept of crew resource management, CRM, that I was reading about in the patient safety literature, and I decided to talk to everybody I could in the aviation industry because it was pretty clear that between the 90s and those of the lifers in the room, us gray-haired, you know, SPs and PPs, we remember, you know, the Everglades crash and the crash in Portland, Oregon, and the crash in Tenerife with KLM and Pan Am, and countless crashes that occurred in the 70s and early 80s, which it turned out had nothing to do with lack of technical proficiency and everything to do with failures in teamwork and communication. Somebody knew something that they weren't telling somebody else. Somebody knew something that they weren't telling anybody else, but they were hoping and hinting, like, you know, maybe there's some land out there, as in a mountain. You know, gee, we seem to be a little low on fuel, as in we're about to crash, get that on the ground. Or somebody blew somebody off, or somebody was intimidated, or whatever. You had the captain as king. Think about the parallels in healthcare. Captain as king, nobody else knew anything because they weren't a captain, right? So a baggage handler saw a bolt on the ground when a first officer was making the go-around of the plane, and the first officer was, well, what do you know about bolts? You're just a baggage handler. Well, you know, it's a little bit of a problem if the engine falls apart. No thank you, no, you know, soliciting input, et cetera. And then finally, they discovered by listening to the voice recorders, the black boxes, which are in fact orange, not black. Think about it. It's, you know, you got a fire, do you want a black box? I found that out was when I started studying aviation. And so they discovered that 75 to 85% of these crashes, it wasn't a mechanical problem, it wasn't a technical problem, it wasn't they didn't know how to fly a plane, it was they didn't know how to function as a team, communicate, listen. Being a team leader is not just about listening, it's about soliciting. Listening isn't enough. And one of the things that troubles me about the emotional intelligence movement is that so many people take away from it this notion that being a leader is like listening. No, being a leader is soliciting so you can listen, making it possible for people to say things so that you can listen. Because if I don't, you know, if you don't say anything, then there's nothing to listen to. So all my listening skills are for naught, and so the issue really is, what do you think, right? But what do you think is predicated on me knowing that you think? Right? That you're not mindless. And in healthcare, we have this notion of mindful and mindless work, which, by the way, nursing is sometimes in danger of reproducing with its own hierarchical, toxically hierarchical categories, right? Because actually, and this is one of the reasons why psych nurses are so important in helping lead these efforts, because you can help, you know, APRNs and RNs and so forth understand that, guess what, the housekeeper has a mind too. And so does the aide, and so does the clerk, and, you know, and when I talk to aides and LPNs, they say about nurses exactly what nurses say about doctors in almost the same words. I mean, you guys have this mantra, nurses eat their young. We got to stop that, you know. People are, it's almost like become prescriptive, right, as opposed to descriptive. I was stunned to hear the doctor say the same thing. So I have two conclusions. Nobody's eating lunch. Everybody's eating each other. And, you know, in healthcare, toxic hierarchy is a gift that keeps on giving, right? And people are at every level socialized in a system in which they do not have team intelligence. They have the antithesis. So I think it's absolutely critical for people to take lessons from an industry like aviation, where they had a bunch of awful crashes, a bunch of awful incidents, where hundreds of people were killed at once. The one difference between aviation and healthcare is that you guys only kill people one by one. And they kind of kill, you know, a whole lot of people at once. It's much more efficient. And so, you know, 200, 150 people go down. And so I've been fascinated by how they transformed the culture in aviation, because now, with the exception of the Asiana crash, which was actually a failure of that airline to put into place crew resource management because of cultural issues, and I mean, in fact, the cockpit of that airliner, that Asiana airliner, much more resembled an American OR than it resembled a cockpit at United or Delta or Air France or BOB, British Air, whatever. And so I think it's critical for people to do what they've done in aviation, which is to learn team intelligence. And they did this in aviation and do this in aviation by having recurrent trainings in team intelligence. They don't call it that, I do. And they teach people how to function on teams. Because guess what? It's not natural. And particularly not in a society where you turn on the television between 9 and 11 every night, and what are people doing? Killing each other. Right? I mean, you know, we're socialized in... In fact, it's very interesting. There's this movie coming out today called Captain Phillips, about Rich Phillips, who was taken by the Somali pirates. And Rich says that he's very upset that the movie is called Captain Phillips, because like Sully Sullenberger, who was kind enough to do the foreword to our book, who landed flight 1549, US Airways 1549, the Hudson, both of them, these two men, say, this was not about me, this was teamwork. We practice teamwork all the time. This should not be called, you know, Captain Phillips, because it was their insistence on training, and more training that that led him to be alive. It wasn't the Navy SEALs. I mean, the Navy SEALs were very important. But they trained, and because his crew went below deck and did all the things that they were supposed to do to sequester themselves so they couldn't take over the ship, that it ended well. And this guy has team intelligence because he knows that it wasn't him. It wasn't just one guy, right? Think of the difference between this and healthcare, right? It never is just one guy. When you make a mistake, it's not just one woman or man, and when you have a success, it isn't. So Team intelligence is critical, but in order to have team intelligence, we have to take advantage of the opportunity. And I believe that for nurses in general, and psych nurses in particular, to finally get their work recognized, there is no better opportunity than the opportunity that is knocking today. And what is the opportunity that is knocking today for you to get voice and authority? You notice I'm not using the word autonomy. I don't like the word autonomy because it's medical autonomy that got us into this problem that we're in today. So I like interdependence. Thank you. I like interdependence. I mean, because if we have just nurses who are functioning according to the medical definition of autonomy, we're just replacing one group that doesn't talk to another group for the first group that doesn't talk to the other group or groups. So I think there's a huge opportunity today for you to get voice and authority. And that is in teamwork, because there is a focus on teamwork now, even though I would argue that there isn't enough effort put into teaching it in the beginning and teaching it consistently. Patient safety is a huge opportunity. I mean, these statistics that I cited are constant headlines, right? People are worried about patient safety. People are worried about the patient experience, patient satisfaction, right? In all your institutions, are they not concerned about this? And then finally, interprofessional education and practice. Everybody is doing IPE, IPC, IPP, IP whatever, right? So this is a huge opportunity for nurses and for psych nurses. Because why is it an opportunity? Because it's an opportunity to reframe and redefine what a team is and what it isn't. And to get the kind of team intelligence that is necessary for patient safety. And to do that, we have to understand the role that everybody on the team plays, which means that people have to work together and people have to articulate together and people have to articulate and speak about what they do. And other people have to listen, right? Because that's the way you create a team. Right now, people define a team as what it is not, right, usually in healthcare. I mean, I've never heard the word team bandied about as much as in healthcare. There's this team and that team. So today in healthcare, there's a tremendous amount of discussion about teamwork. There's a tremendous amount of discussion about teamwork. But a team is often defined. There's a lot of discussion about teamwork, but often a team is just defined as a bunch of people collected around the patient or on the unit or in the clinic or whatever it is. And I define that as a group of intimate strangers engaged in parallel play at the bedside, in the clinic, at the chairside, whatever, right? That isn't a team. A team is an aggregate of persons with specific individual interactive roles, a distributed set of skills, and with shared and explicit purposes, goal, information, plans, protocol, feedback mechanisms, and so forth, briefings, debriefings. People understand what each other does on a team. I have heard chief residents in hospitals say to a dean of nursing in one case, could you explain to me what nurses do? I've never really understood. And I'm like, can you imagine a quarterback saying, you know, could you explain to me what those defensive ends are? I mean, I've never, you know, what is it that the linebackers do? I've never really understood that. I mean, it's incomprehensible. It's impossible for that to happen. I think that this definition of teamwork is really important. It's by J. Richard Hackman, who's at Harvard, and he says that in order to have a team be a team instead of just a team in name only, it has to have a compelling and shared direction for its work. So the nurse can't think that we're doing one thing and the physician the other and the social worker the other and the pharmacist the other.
right? It has to have an enabling structure that facilitates teamwork, and I'm going to return to this later, but an enabling structure like people actually talk to each other. I mean, as opposed to writing notes and charts, right? As opposed to the psych nurse saying one thing and the psychiatrist saying another thing and the pulmonologist saying another thing and the cardiologist, all of them changing and none of them ever chatting with each other about these complicated cases that you're taking care of. That was the first thing that impressed me or depressed me when I went into healthcare from covering many other fields is how little people talk to each other. Now, psych is different sometimes. Sometimes, which is another reason why you have the opportunity to play a leadership role, because you have at least some experience of what faced the creative, productive power of face-to-face communication, which many in healthcare literally lack as if they lacked a limb, right? They do not get it. Teamwork has to function within a supportive organizational context. I was just talking to a psych NP, and he was talking about the lack of supportive organizational contact for interdisciplinary, interprofessional care because people were not given time to talk to each other because the managers of the clinic did not want to carve out an hour where the primary care doc and the nurses and the pharmacist and whoever could all get together because that was 4 15-minute slots times 10 that would be taken away from productivity. So that's not a supportive organizational context, right? People can be prepared to talk to each other and then not given the time to talk, which is, I'm going to return to this because this is super critical. And finally, you have to have expert coaching. Again, psych nurses come into this. Just getting the patient out better than they came in, whatever it is, whatever the problem, isn't enough. You have to produce a good product, a patient who can cope, a patient who takes their meds, a patient who feels better, a patient who doesn't have an injury or dies, right? But also, and this is critical, the process through which that input, that output is produced has to enhance the ability of the team to work together in the future. In other words, you're taking care of a patient together, and you have so much conflict that the patient's okay, but you feel literally ill when you see another doctor, nurse, pharmacist, PT, social worker, whatever. You feel sick about it. That is not teamwork. That's people managing in spite of teamwork. The team has to be able to work together again, right? And you have examples of that, and those examples we need to learn about. And if you don't have examples of that and you have examples of the negative, then we have to learn from them to see what we shouldn't do. And this is fundamental. The process through which the team or group works must make people feel better about themselves. So if you feel like you just, you know, got the patient out by the skin of their teeth and you could have missed this, that, and the other thing, you know, when you leave work, which so many nurses in so many fields say, that is not good teamwork. That is, again, you've done it in spite of it. And that means that you don't have a supportive organizational context. I mean, if nurses, in whatever field they say, insist that they don't have time, that they have too heavy workloads, et cetera, et cetera, then we have a big problem because we have to listen to them as opposed to saying that they're lazy or, you know, I don't know, they're just trying to do whatever it is they're trying to do. People are being run ragged in healthcare today, and that is antithetical to teamwork. I believe that team intelligence is the active capacity of individual members of a team to learn, teach, communicate, reason, and think together, irrespective of position in a hierarchy, in the service of realizing shared goals and a shared mission. I believe this represents what I call team intelligence. The rim, the violet rim, is the intelligence that holds the team together. And if you don't have team intelligence, you have a pretty bumpy ride. Think of riding on a bike with no rim. And that's often what we have in healthcare today, too often. Often I ask people to rate the teamwork that they have on their unit, in their workplace, in their school, wherever, because this team intelligence is everywhere. It's all over life, right? Whatever job you have to do. I ask them to rate it before I give these definitions of teamwork, and then on a scale of 1 to 10, with 1 being the lowest, 10 being the highest, and then to look over, to reconsider their score in light of what I've just told you and the kind of redefinition of teamwork. And sometimes people will get a higher score, and sometimes people will get a lower score, because that's not often what teamwork is. In fact, often people will say, you know, she speaks up too much, she's not a team player. If you don't have a boat rocker on your team, you don't have a team. I mean, you could have a group, you could have a dysfunctional group, but you don't have a team. People have to be able to speak up about problems. Now, they have to also know how to speak up about problems, right? Which is why you do team training, because you don't want to say, are you trying to kill that patient? Right? Or what the met? Right? You have to learn how to constructively frame your input. And that's tough in healthcare settings where people are under tremendous stress, are eating each other rather than lunch, and are often fatigued, which is a real teamwork killer. Fatigue is terrible for teamwork. We tend to focus in healthcare on the top of the pyramid. How many of you have gone to lectures where you've heard people talk about excellence and we have to be the 1% and all that kind of, you know, the top of the pyramid? And every time I hear one of those lectures, I think, well, actually, patients depend upon the whole pyramid. And if you don't have the base, you don't actually have a pyramid because, like, there's nothing holding the top up, right? And nurses need to fill in those spaces with discussions of their work, because in this case, the brick and mortar of the pyramid is your explaining what you do so that you can do it. I have spent some time, a lot of time, talking to psych nurses, and some of what they say is really interesting, that when they're in a primary care practice, people don't really understand what they do, so that they're underutilized. Imagine one of the most profound problems we have in this country and probably the world is this division between the mental and the physical, right? And what problem doesn't have, I don't want to medicalize life and over-psychiatrize or whatever, psychologize life, but if a person is weighing 300 pounds and is keeping eating Cinnabons, you know, and other terrible things and won't adhere to their to diet, or has, you know, is self-medicating with food or drink or whatever, is that not something a psych nurse could help with, right? Not just a nutritionist. And wouldn't you want the PCP and the endocrinologist, because that person maybe has diabetes too? And of course, you as psych nurses know about diabetes meds, so that's another plus. So there are so many ways that one can imagine psych nurses being utilized. Now, I also had some interesting chats with some psych nurses who talked about the problem of psych nurses, in particular psych NPs and clinical specialists, being used not to deliver the holistic care that they're educated to deliver, but to just be med pushers and med managers. And we have a big problem in our insurance reimbursement because the incentives are to not do talking and medication management, if it's appropriate, but to just do med management. because, for example, in the state I used to live in, Blue Cross pays $180 for an NP to do individual med management therapy, but pays $135 for half of that time. And so a nurse can earn $270 if she or he does less talk and more med management. So the incentive is perverse. The incentive, I mean, in other words, if we had really good incentives, the half hour or, you know, whatever that half of 50 minutes is, 30, 25 minutes, would be $90, not $135, right? So you are not angels. You are human beings, and people follow the money. Another perverse incentive is what I mentioned before, which is the challenge to address the terrible productivity pressures in healthcare, which are keeping nurses, doctors, pharmacists, social workers, PTs, OTs, wherever they work, from being teams, from practicing together, from talking together, as this young NP, or he probably isn't so young, and I think he's in the audience, was telling me, once the primary care practice and providers understand what psych NPs do, they're thrilled for the psych NPs to take the mental health patients. And they offload the patients onto the psych NP, but then they never talk with the psych NP about the patients. So it's not interprofessional care, because to do interprofessional care, it means you are doing it, you are learning with, from, and about each other. And learning with, from, and about the patient, with, from, and about each other. Simply referring the patient to the NP and then never talking to the NP about the patient is not interprofessional practice. Right? And it isn't teamwork. It's the same old, with slightly more respect and understanding involved. And that doesn't help the patient, and that doesn't deal with the patient safety problem. So I think that one of the hugest problems that we have in teamwork in healthcare today is not simply getting people to accept it and learn team intelligence, but getting the time and getting rid of these horrible productivity pressures. You know, when I started writing about nursing in 1986, there were all these studies about nurse practitioners and how great they were, and, you know, they were studies about how the difference in the outcomes with patients, and what was the difference, the fundamental difference, was that the nurse practitioner took the time to ask critical questions, wherever the nurse practitioner was, to ask critical questions about the patient and to discover critical issues about the patient that were going to affect patient safety and outcome. And that was when the nurse practitioner had like 45 minutes with a patient. And now NPs, wherever they are, it's the same, get them in, get them out, get them in, get them out, get them in, get them out. And people are... healthcare is being tailorized, and you cannot deliver the holistic care that you are educated to deliver in that kind of environment. It is impossible. It is not possible to get the whole story. And the whole story is what saves patients' lives, right? So this is what I believe we have to fight for. And the whole story isn't the dose of the drug, right? Or which drug to give. So my challenge to you and your challenge to everyone else is, how do you create teamwork? Well, one of the first things you have to do to create teamwork is to talk about what you do, to talk about not only the what but the how. And I want to end with a couple of stories that I've been really impressed with that psych nurses have told me that I've learned just recently. Two stories, and if we had more time, I would get all of you to tell stories to each other, because it's fun to do that kind of exercise, to talk about, you know, in a very short amount of time, what you pick up when you have the time to really listen to your patients and to really attend to all the incredibly complex details that go into your work. But I was just talking to a friend of mine whose son has had a lot of heart-wrenching mental health problems. And his son was in a state hospital because, of course, the fundamental challenge in mental health is just the tragic lack of resources for mental health care. And there's a great movie that was just done in Vermont called The Hungry Heart about a pediatric practice that deals with young kids who are addicted to prescription drugs. And I would really recommend it because it talks, it's another illustration of this tragic underfunding of mental health in this country. I mean, one almost despairs being that we don't have a government. How can we get, funding for mental health? But again, he was talking about his son had always said to the psychiatrist who was managing his meds that he heard voices. And the psychiatrist was okay, great, we'll give you this drug and that drug. And they were just, doing this cascade of drugs. Well, that doesn't work. How about this, et cetera, et cetera. And my friend said, it's like he's kind of a guinea pig, right? And they're experimenting. Well, when he was in the hospital, finally, one of the psych nurses asked him what the voices were saying, which the psychiatrist had never done. And who were the voices? Who are these people? Tell me what they say. And he said, well, they're not anybody. It's my self-talk. He didn't put it that way, but what transpired was it was his own negative ruminations. He wasn't hearing Jesus or Florence Nightingale or Obama or Osama or, anybody. He was listening to himself. He was having these negative ruminations, right? And he wasn't hearing voices, it turns out. In other words, nobody had bothered to find out that what he called voices, which they interpreted as delusions and hallucinations, thus ex-meds, was just his negative ruminations. Well, that kind of changed everything, didn't it? Right? This was a nurse, a psych nurse, listening to a patient as opposed to going over doses and meds. And the whole plan of care changed. He's out of the hospital. He's doing better. He's getting appropriate therapy. Amazing. It isn't, but it is in our world. Finally, the other story is there was a psych NP who was dealing with a patient, a young woman who had been hit by a car and had a traumatic brain injury, was very depressed and had been discharged from the hospital, was on all these meds, and she came in for a visit. And the psych nurse was going over the meds and also her life and was asking her first about, how is she doing with the meds, et cetera. And the nurse and the woman said, fine, check, fine. And the psych nurse said, she didn't like the way the woman was saying fine. There was a nuance, right? This is also a story about why technology can't substitute for human beings. And she said to the woman, the young patient, it must be terribly difficult for you. Having just been a perfectly healthy girl, you were walking down the street, get hit by a car, now you have to take all these meds and da-da-da-da-da. And the young woman said, oh, it's no problem, I'm not taking anything. I'm not taking anything until I get my dog back. Turned out, when she got hit by the car, she had a dog. Her parents took the dog. They couldn't take care of the dog and her. They gave the dog away. And for this woman, the dog represented everything she had lost. And she wasn't going to take her meds.